What's happening, people? I'm here with the main man.
It's the champ. Make
sure you tune into Talk UK, where it talks boxing and
big up.
Thank you, AJ.
Talk UK.
Oi, oi. Welcome to the Pep Talk UK Sports Podcast, the podcast that talks the major boxing and football news from around the globe. Real points of view from a real panel. Hashtag real talk on Pep Talk. Please subscribe to Pep Talk UK on iTunes and YouTube. Don't forget to like, share and comment. Now I'm your host Frankie B. And this week we feature a bunch of young talented lads looking to have a big 2018. Let's hear from Adrian the Ruler Redman, Yasser El Jenna, Yusef Super Kamari, Jerome Stay Ready Campbell, Kyan Tech Thomas, Ozzy Javier, and the Professor X of the camp, Xavier Miller.
Pep Talk UK are joined by one of the X-Men. He's a super middleweight, making his debut on the 3rd of March on a Goodwin show. It's Mr. Adrian Redman. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well, thanks.
Xavier, what's he like to train under?
I'd say he's perfect for me. I can't speak for anybody else, but I assume it's the same because the camp just keeps on growing. But he's like a teacher and he's passionate about what he's teaching, so it makes you comfortable and confident to listen to him.
Now, in terms of your background, you're about to make your debut.
Yeah.
Amateur experience, pedigree, what did you do before this?
Well, I only had 15 amateur fights, but my progress was vast. In comparison to the amount of fights I had, so we felt comfortable and we made the decision that it was the right time to turn over.
Now, in terms of amateur clubs, where were you fighting, or whose banner were you fighting under?
Yeah, I was training under IQ, the same club that I'm under now.
Quality. And in terms of your fight coming up, pro debut, pressure, nerves?
Definitely the nerves. I wouldn't so much say pressure, but definitely the nerves.
And how much of an army you got coming? How much of a Redman army you got?
Yeah, all of my people's coming to support me. Friends, family, they've shown me a lot of love. So.
In terms of nicknames, have you picked one up yet?
Yeah, the Ruler.
The Ruler?
Yeah, Adrian the Ruler Redman.
I like that. That's original as well.
Yeah.
Well, we at Pep Talk are going to be following your career. We wish you the best of luck on your debut. Go get that win.
Thank you.
Cheers, brother. Take care.
Take care.
Pep Talk UK are joined by another young X-Man. He made his debut not so long ago and won in style. His name is Yasser El Jenna. How you doing, Yas?
How are you, man?
Now, Yasser, you're known by a nickname which most people use. What's your nickname?
Yassi Boy.
Yassi Boy. Where did you pick that name up from?
Well, I'm half Spanish, so my grandma used to call me Yassi, so I just put the boy there in front of it.
So Yassi Boy.
Yeah.
You're a good looking lad. I've seen your social media profile. You're getting a bit of love on social media, didn't
you? Yeah, man. Gotta keep building the profile.
Now tell me about your background. Amateur, what turned you to boxing?
I'll say when I first started boxing, I think I was about 16, 17. Started a bit late, but I used to get in a lot of trouble, so I used to like fighting. I had anger problems, so I started off boxing. I think first time I stepped into the gym, so I think I was about 16. Then I did look back.
Where did you step into what gym?
It was Finchley ABC.
And then did you move on to have some amateur fights?
Yeah, I had about 42 fights, 42 years amateur.
And how did you get on with the amateur?
I think it was half-half. I think I won half.
And then you decide to turn pro. What weight are you fighting at?
Welterweight.
And your debut, talk me through it.
I'll say I was nervous a little bit in the change room, but it was like a good nerve. Yeah. But once I got out and I came out on my ring entrance, I was fine. Confidence was gone. And then, once I stepped in the ring, nerves were gone. And I just buzzing to go.
Your next fight is already up?
Yeah, 3rd of March. You're cool.
You're going to bring your Yassi Boy army with you?
Yeah, man. Have to.
Well, we at Pep Talk are going to be there. We'll be watching you on the day. We wish you the best of luck. Go get that win.
I appreciate it, man.
Cheers, my brother.
Thank you. Take care, man.
Pep Talk UK are joined by another one of the X-Men. It's Yusuf Kumari. How you doing, Yusuf?
Good, man. How are you?
I'm well. Now, Yusuf, you've got yourself a little nickname in the middle of that, Yusuf Kumari. What's your nickname?
No, they call me Super, innit?
They call you Super?
Call me Super.
Now, is that something your friends call you, your stable mates call you, your trainer calls you?
Well, it started with my coach, Zav, and it just grew from there. Now, everyone calls me it.
You're now 3-0. You've got your fourth fight coming up.
Yeah.
On the 17th of March.
Yeah.
Goodwin show again.
Yeah, I think so.
How's training been going?
Training's good, you know. I've just had a good Christmas and New Year's and that, so I'm back in the gym. I'd never left the gym, but I'm back in the gym, getting the weight back down. Pretty much ready to go now, to be honest, so I'm ready whenever.
Now, you're a good looking lad. what are your origins? Where's your family from?
I'm mixed, so I'm half Moroccan. And my mother's side's Filipino, so...
What side dominates?
50-50, isn't it?
Yeah.
We'll leave it at that,
50-50. Things you like about training, things you dislike about training?
To be honest, I just like sparring. I just love sparring. When I come in the gym, I just want to spar. I'm not really bothered about bags or pads. I just like sparring.
Any notable people you've sparred? Any other pros?
This time around with Ashley Theophane, Michael Devine, there's a lot I can't really remember, innit? It's the guys in the gym as well. So, yeah, just, I don't really remember, you know.
Good old Treasure, good old Chunky Luton.
Yeah, not bad.
In terms of your training regime, what's your training regime on, say, a weekly basis, Monday to Friday? What do you do?
Well, in the mornings I'm in the gym. So, 3 times a week I'll be in the boxing gym. So that's sparring, training, whatnot. And then twice a week as well, I'm at strength conditioning. So I've got to do all the strength conditioning, all the weights and that sort of thing. Just getting myself ready for war, really.
And what about weight? What weight do you fight at?
Lightweight. So I ain't got that much to use. I only walk around 2 kilos above my fighting weight. So
you're always ready?
I'm always ready. You can call me tomorrow.
2018, what are you targeting? What do you want to achieve this year?
Get as close to the southern area as possible, if not get it.
I like that, yeah. I like that. A man with confidence. Yeah. If not, get it. Let's see, come December, you might be walking around with a Southern Area belt.
Never know, maybe even English.
Well, however it goes, we at Pep Talk are going to be watching you.
Thank you.
Good luck with your career, good luck with the rest of the year.
Thank you.
And look, there's the bell.
Time to start training.
Have a good day, my brother.
Thank you,
Cheers,
too, man.
Buddy.
Cheers.
Pep Talk UK are joined by another one of the X-Men.
Jerome, stay ready, Campbell. You know what I'm saying?
Now, Jerome, do you know later on in life when that tag hits the X-Men?
Yeah.
Shaz is the one that's
Yeah, Shaz, Pep Talk UK, yeah?
Yeah, that's it. Don't let none of these little, like, EJ or anyone else
sure you
say
hold
that
on to that. I'll make sure you hold on to that, bro.
Now, my brother, you have been watching your career through the amateurs. Tell me about your amateur background.
So, yeah, I started off at Norfolk. Then I progressed to Finchley. Then due to the spit with England boxing, I went to Islington. I had 35 fights in all, and I won 20 out of them. So that's a good record, obviously. With amateur boxing, you hear a lot of boxers say, I won this match, I got robbed this match or whatever, but that's part of the game, so you know, just take it on the chin. I won the Box Cup, I reached the National Novice Finals, and I had a good season in my last season, so you know, it was ready for me to take it to the next step and turn pro.
Tell me who you've signed with.
So I've signed with Steve Goodwin. Obviously, what happened was I came down to have a meeting with Zav about turning pro. Obviously, we had a intimate kind of relationship in the amateurs. We always used to talk, so it was always there. It was always, the foundations were built for us to take that step. Came down and spoke to Zav. He arranged it for me to go and speak to Steve. When I spoke to Steve, the vision that he had for me, not only just as a boxer but marketing and everything, for me it just felt like it was the right decision in my position right now for me to do and sign with him.
Now, You mentioned Xavier, Professor X himself.
Pro X.
How's your relationship with him? How do you get on with your trainer? Well, does he put you through the paces?
Definitely puts me through the paces. Like, anyone that can see us work together will understand and see. Anyone that sees us work together will understand and see the chemistry between us is crazy. It's different. Like, everyone that's come to see me train with him can say, yo, you lot have a, like, there's a fire there. You know what I'm saying? There's, I think that he cares about all his boxers. And when you have that as a boxer, let me tell you, when someone cares about you and has the enthusiasm to push you and join on this journey with you, it's a refreshing feeling, man. It's a very dope feeling for you to have as a boxer. It spurs you.
Pro debut coming up
March the 3rd. Plug.
What weight are you coming in at?
Lightweight.
And in terms of a crowd, how much of a following are you going to have there at your pool?
Well, I'd like to say the hundreds, but we'll see if people really keep up to their word, innit? You know, it's my debut. I want to get all the support I can. In this year, I definitely want to work on building a support base and a backing, whether it's from supporters, sponsorships, anything to help get behind Team Stay Ready. You know what I'm saying? I hope people jump on the bandwagon now, because when the gravy train moving, they're going to try and dip their potatoes in it. You feel me?
Well, Stay Ready is already ready. Ready, I reckon, man. You're ready for debut tomorrow.
Listen. You hear that? I'm banging my belly now.
My brother, we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you so much,
Pep,
man.
Pep Talk are there from day one. We're going to be supporting your journey. I've seen you in the amateurs.
Respect.
I like what I've seen.
Respect.
And I just hope you like your conversations and your gravy conversations.
Yeah, man.
You transition to being a pro.
I think it's inevitable. I think, you know what it is? I know I'm destined for great things. Without sounding big-headed or egotistic, because I'm a very humble and grounded person, I know I'm destined for great things. It's just the rest of the world need to see it now, innit?
Listen, the one thing I always say to people is, if you don't sell yourself, no one else is going to come and do your sales pitch for you.
Man, that's it.
My advice to you would be, tell everyone how good you are, and go on back out.
Yes, that's exactly what it is, man.
Well, my brother, you take care. We'll catch up with you March 3rd.
You take care too, man. See you there.
Nice one, buddy. Pep Talk UK are joined by another one of the X-Men who train under Professor X. It's Kian Tech Thomas. How you doing, Kian?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
My brother, you've now moved over to Professor X. Yep. Xavier.
Yes.
What made you move over?
You know, I was previously at St Pancras with my coach. We decided to set ourselves apart. I was there for 13 years as an amateur and as a pro, so it was time. And I've known X for a long time from the amateurs, and I just like the way he works. I like his mentality towards the game. You know, every time I see him, he's got good things to say to me and good tips, and you know, he said, let me get a ticket to your fight, and you know, and I saw the stable building up over here, and I saw the fighters, good fighters. And I thought, I want a bit of that. I want, you know, be there to be able to spar them every day and, you know, to be part of that training. I want that. So I decided that this was the right place to come to.
Already 8-0?
Yes.
What you got planned for 2018?
Well, just to build on that, you know, I need to get the 8-rounders in, the 10-rounders, and then I'm looking at a title, Southern Area, English title, Eliminator, then the English title. That's what I'm looking at, really. That's what I believe that I should be looking at. It's getting experience and getting the titles now. So,
well, one step towards that,
mm-hmm,
is you already got a fight date. When are you next out?
I'm next out February the 10th at York Hall, as soon as possible.
Look, yeah. You're not wasting any time,
nah, not at all, man. You know, I got to get, keep the ball rolling. Last time I was out was in October in the World Boxing Super Series. I was out on that, and I didn't get out in December, which I wanted to, but that's what I said to my manager, look, that's cool, get me out as soon as possible. First one I want to be at, so we are.
How did you find the experience of fighting on the WBS card?
It was good. I mean, it's the same to me as fighting at York Hall, but in people's eyes it's different. You know, the fight's a fight to me. I fought in Spain, I fought in Finland, I fought in all kinds of places, you know, and Wembley is... because it's iconic to people like the fans that see him. Oh yeah, Keane's fighting at Wembley, Keane's fighting on this. It matters to them, but to me, it's a fight and I still got to win the fight.
A ring's a ring.
Exactly, you know what I'm saying? Exactly, could be anywhere, you know, I still got to win it. That's what matters more than anything. So yeah, it meant a lot in terms of getting exposure. I was on TV, you know, it was a good performance. I stopped him. So, you know, it's great. It was great in terms of that.
Well, Ken, we at Pep Talk are going to be following your journey.
Thank
we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much.
Productive 2018. Uh-huh. And we hope by the time I get around to you next time, man, you got a strap round your waist.
Definitely.
You're not going to try and tax that strap off you, innit?
Yeah?
Nah, that year just meant I'm going to knock you out. Nah.
Get your gloves.
Yeah, no, that's man. Why I'll bring a baseball bat. Thank you very much for
Thank
your time
you
today, brother. I hope training camp goes well and good luck with your next fight.
Thank you.
Cheers, my brother.
Cheers.
Pep Talk UK are joined by a man Manning who's just given me a lesson in pronunciation, and I'm not going to argue because you're going to bust me up. It's Ozzy Javier. How you doing, Ozzy?
I'm good.
You weren't really going to beat me up, were you?
No, I wasn't going to beat you up, man. I'm disciplined in that field now, you know. Back in the day and now, it's just two different things, you know.
Ozzy, you've moved over to Professor X, Xavier Miller.
Yeah.
How are you settling into his stable of fighters?
I'm settling good. Some of the fighters I knew before. That's how it is when you're a boxer. Everybody really knows everyone in the game. So I've moved over. The information and what he's teaching me is brilliant. You know, it feels like it's a part of me and things that I really want to do. You know what I'm saying? And the guys have been great with me as well. You know, I knew Yusuf from way back, you know, and I see that, can't remember his name, you know, but I was amateurs with him at Finchley. Yasser, that's it, Yasser.
I didn't even prompt you, you got there yourself.
Yeah, and Keon Thomas, when I started in amateurs, well, not starting amateurs, when I decided to have my first fights in that, he was there. We've travelled like to Wales, Denmark, Scotland and stuff like that, do you know what I mean? So
you've already been in some wars. You've had
some
good fights already.
Listen, these wars and everything, like, people probably think that, right, look at his record, but then you have to look at, if you really know boxing, you have to look at the opponents actually on my resume and see that I stepped up after three fights. I stepped up and I started boxing all these guys, you know what I'm saying?
Now, you've had your time at cruiserweight.
Yeah.
You're moving down in weight now, aren't you?
Yeah, they're giving me an allowance that I can come in at 83, my next fight, you know, so losing the weight as it is already, yeah.
You're looking shredded, you're looking better.
Of course, I'm looking better, feeling better, you know what I mean?
Now, you said your next fight, where can we come watch you?
Come watch me at York Hall, Bethnal Green. That's where you come watch me on Saturday, the 10th of March, 2018.
Javier, I hope you have a fantastic 2018.
It's going to be fantastic. You've got to be positive all the time, even when things ain't going the way you want it to go. But that's one of the hard things to do. Keep positive when things ain't going your way.
Javier, I'm not going to say anything against you, mate, because like I said, I've seen you box, I've seen the power, and I reckon you're going to have a fantastic 2018. So from everyone at Pep Talk, we wish you the best of luck. We'll be following the journey.
Yeah, follow the journey. And everybody else, whoever's listening to this, follow the journey.
Nice.
You know, I'm a G and I'm not being talking about a gangster. I'm greatness and that's it. Come and watch me. I'm ready to go. This is that time. Everything, all circumstances is out of the way. And now it's ready for war. People are going to be getting it. I know this.
Loving it. You have a good one, my brother. Take
you
it.
Too. Thank you. Bye.
Pep Talk UK are joined by a young trainer who's looking to make a mark in 2018. And he's got a band of merry men who I like to call the X-Men because of his name.
Yeah.
Mr. Xavier Miller. How you doing, Xavier?
I'm not too bad.
We've had you on the podcast.
Yeah.
But since you've been on, you seem to have gone on a signing spree. You've got a lot of pro boxers under your belt now, haven't you?
I think probably another five since I last spoke to you guys, yeah.
So I'm just going to do it the easy way. Okay. Run me through the pros you've got.
All right. I'll try and go in weight order, make it easier. I've got Dennis, Lights Out, We're Home. He's 1-0, had his debut back in December, I think. I've got Jerome, Stay Ready Campbell, lightweight. He's got his pro debut on the 3rd of March. Got Yusuf Kamari, Yusuf Super Kamari. He's 3-0. He's out again on the 17th of March. I've got Kay Prosper, who's got an English title eliminator. I think it's on the 10th of March. He's 11-1, yeah. And I've got Yassi Boy, welterweight. He had his pro debut in December, 3rd of December. He's out again on the 3rd of March. I've got Kian Thomas. He's out on the 10th of February. He's 8-0. That's another welterweight. We've got Tunji Uncle T. He's 4-0. He's out again on the 3rd of March. Welterweight, light middleweight. I've got Adrian Redman, who's a super middleweight. He's got his pro debut on the 3rd of March. And Ozzy Xavier out on the 10th of March. And I think Ozzy's on the belt. I think it's going to be a 9th bout, I think. 9th or 10th.
9th or 10th bout. Now, impressive. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 pro fighters.
Yeah.
That's quite a stable. Now, another common denominator is they're all managed and promoted by Mr. Steve Goodwin.
Yes. Yep.
How'd you get on working with Steve?
Great. Don Charles introduced me to Steve. I like his shows. Very well organised. And we speak all the time. Ask me about what weight the fighters are at the moment. Gives me plenty of notice for their bouts. The whole setup there is very, very well organised. So yeah, the relationship's really good between me and Steve.
Well, Xavier, as much as I like talking to you, I'm going to get cracking with some of your boxers.
Yep, great.
And see what they've got to say about you.
Brilliant.
And if they say anything bad, I'll whisper it back to you and play it back to you first.
That's
and you
all
can
right.
put them through proper sessions.
That's all right. I can still fight a bit, so that's all right.
Nice one, Xavier. Right, you
thanks.
Take care.
Take care.
And again, thank you for giving us the time and access to all your boxers.
Anytime.
Cheers, buddy.
A massive big up to the group of fighters they call the X-Men. Now to the football interviews. And this week we hear from two League One players playing their trade for AFC Wimbledon. First up, let's hear from the rock at the back, Deji Ojalaja.
Oi, oi. It's Frankie B reporting for Pep Talk UK. And I'm joined by the AFC Wimbledon star defender, Deji Ojalaja. How you doing, mate?
Yeah, I'm good, man. I'm good, man. How you doing, man? You good?
I'm doing well. You know, shout out to Chris Congo, you know.
Hey, my dog, you know.
For putting the plug in and all that. So, last time out, you had a good victory over Blackpool, 2-0 victory. Another clean sheet, just a bit of breathing space above the relegation zone. How do you think this season's going to pan out?
Do you know what's mad? It's one of them ones where, like, so far, obviously, like, we're improving all the time. And obviously, you can see, those who watch our games, they can see that we're improving every game by game. So we're not really getting ahead of ourselves or anything like that. We're just trying to tick off games. And then, obviously, hopefully, we'll play these two games in hand. And then we'll see where we are. And then, hopefully, by the end of the season, we'll finish off strong. And then you never know where we can end up.
It's crazy because, looking at the table, you guys are quite secure defensively. But it seems like goals is the key to really revive your season and make sure you have a good finish. Would you agree with that point?
Yeah, man. Like, obviously, I think our defensive record has been decent, but obviously we haven't contributed goals like all the way through the team. So that's on the strikers, that's on the midfield, that's on defenders as well. All of us need to chip in with the goals to help them out as well. But we've got some quality strikers here. And obviously we signed Joe now, and Joe got a goal as well, so that's good for his confidence as well. Obviously Lyle Taylor and Cody McDonald. So obviously we've got some good striking options, and obviously once they start banging off like more regularly, and all of us, then I'm sure we'll climb that table easily.
What about yourself? Are you going to chip in with a few more goals?
Yeah, I need to. I'm actually decent in front of goal as well, you know, but I just ain't really had a chance like that, but it's loading.
Yeah. Well, you know what? On to yourself. What about yourself going forward? I mean, how is your season panned out on a personal level, and what are you looking to achieve in the future moving ahead?
On a personal level, my season's been very good, to be fair. I think I performed well. But obviously, my main aim right now is just to contribute as much as I can to the team. Obviously, my aim is to play as high as possible, and obviously, with AFC, I'd be happy to do that. But obviously, I need to obviously just focus on the now, focus on where I'm at playing right now, prove myself to be a very good defender in this league, and then obviously we'll see where I end up in the future.
And we move forward to Bradford. That's the upcoming game. How do you think that game's going to go? I mean, you likely to put up a good fight against Bradford?
Yeah, of course, man. I think any team takes confidence when they win a game as well. And also, that's 3 clean sheets on the bounce as well in the league. So obviously, we'll take confidence from that. But obviously we know Bradford's got good quality. They got some good players. Obviously my boy is there, Jake Reeves as well. Obviously he's a good player, but obviously we beat them here last time around, so obviously they'd want to get one back against us. But obviously I'm sure if we perform and we stay solid like today, and then our attackers do what they did today, I'm sure we'll give them some problems.
Cracking stuff. Before we go, I'd just like to say for a 24-year-old, mate, you're quite a stocky geezer, mate. Have you been eating your jollof rice?
I've been eating that pound of jam, man. You know, it's pound of jam. I'm telling you, hey, load up on the pound of jam, man. You'll be all right, I'm telling you.
Like cracking stuff, Deji.
Hey, shout out Pep Talk, man. You get me, man. Baddest everything in the game, you get me. Showing love out there, man. You get me.
Thank you, Deji. Finally, let's hear from a man that got himself on the score sheet last weekend. It's Liam Trotter.
Oi, oi. It's Frankie B, reporting for Pep Talk UK. And I'm joined by the AFC midfielder. I'll allow him to introduce himself.
Liam Trotter.
Liam, last time out, you managed to help your team to get an important victory over Blackpool. It's a very, very tight league. There's a cluster of teams all fighting for survival. Are things going to be okay?
I believe so, yeah. You know, you can never count your chickens or anything, but I think we have everything we need to pull ourselves out of this position. I think all season we've performed relatively well in a lot of games and not taking the points. Yeah. I think now there's maybe been a change of the tide. You know, we're performing well and getting points, or at least getting a draw. So, you know, we're all confident that we can pull ourselves out of this, but we still need to knuckle down and make sure it happens.
As I was referring to Deji was you guys, you're very solid defensively, but goals win games. Is it a question of sharing the goals around the team?
Yeah, of course. You know, we've been great defensively, but you know, people like Deji and Darius would be the first to admit that they need to also start getting on the score sheet as well. And you know, we defend as a team and we attack as a team. We can't rely on our strikers to score all our goals. So, you know, Joe Piggott, his debut, he comes on, he gets a goal, so now he's off the mark as well. And you know, it's important to share everything: defence, attack. You know, passing, it's all a team game, so it's important that we all play our part in it.
Right, well, next up, Bradford City, who are flying high in the top five of the league. It's going to be a tall ox away from home, but, you know, there's always hope, isn't there?
Yeah, of course. We played Bradford a few weeks ago and we managed to get the win, so you know, that'll give us confidence. But going to, you know, the Valley Parade is very, very difficult. It's a great stadium and the fans really get behind them, and they've always got really good home form every season, so it's going to be really difficult. But we're in good form, you know, and we're confident, and we're going to go there. We're going to try and perform like we did today, and who knows, we can come away with a result.
Cracking stuff, Liam.
Yeah, everybody get listening to Pep Talk.
Thank you, boys. All the best for the rest of the season. Let's go AFC Wimbledon. Right, it's football time, and I'm joined with the Pep Talk boy, Pascal. How you doing, bro?
Tout va bien, Frankie B. I'm not too bad. And yourself, how's it going?
I'm not too bad, mate. Transfer talk, mate. And particularly what we're going to talk about, we're going to talk about the Mkhitaryan and Sanchez swap. Now, I suppose you can look at it from two angles. You can look at it from the Arsenal side of things. Have they got rid of an unhappy player and replaced him with a happier player? Or from Man United, is it a player they're picking up that's going to get them closer to Man City?
You know, Frankie B, is an interesting point. I don't believe that neither. I believe that Sanchez was more happier to leave Arsenal to join Manchester United than Mkhitaryan was to join Arsenal, if that makes sense. You know, had Mkhitaryan had a choice, he would have preferred to stay, you know, in the squad, as being part of the squad at Manchester, you know. And it, to me, looked like it was a forced move to allow Sanchez to go the other way, and he's the out of favor player. And I'm not sure whether Arsenal benefits from that, because you know, for a team to perform, you have to have the players that want to play for the team. And if Mkhitaryan feels like he's, you know, he's been pushed into a move the other way, I'm not sure that can benefit from it.
To the Europa League, he's been pushed.
Exactly, you know. he's been pushed for a club that is supposed to be the biggest club in the UK. you know, in England, and unfortunately his form has not given him the opportunity to retain his place. And you know, they're making way for him because they prefer Sanchez, and Sanchez wants to go. We knew that he wanted to go for quite some time, and he's an ambitious player, and Manchester United certainly are an ambitious club. So the fact that they've committed, you know, to pay him virtually £40 million a year shows me that they are willing to put the money where their mouth is, you know, and it's a show of intent, you know.
Mourinho, he did say, I need to spend more money to bridge the gap. Now, the board have backed him, funny enough, and he's got a player that we know can assist and that can score goals. And Man United have suffered a bit this season with lack of clinical finishing, and Sanchez certainly is a clinical finisher of the highest order.
Yes, I completely agree with you, Frankie B. I believe that the move was sanctioned because, you know, they know that Sanchez is a premium player, you know, and we've said this before, he would make any team in the Premier League, any other team in the world, a better player and a better team. You know, he's got that quality, that star quality, he's a world-class player, you know, and he certainly was going to be the envy of many other teams. But what I'm surprised about is that Manchester City were not willing to match the valuation, you know, of Manchester United.
Well, it shows, yeah, it's according to the situation. You know, they are streaks ahead in the Premier League. They're doing well in Europe. Had they been Man United in their position, I think they would have coughed up the pee.
I believe so. I believe they'll have coughed up the pee on it. But, you know, it's concerning because, you know, Manchester City may well be planning some very big moves this summer, you know. But by missing out on Sanchez, they may well appease the fans by buying some bigger players.
And Sanchez hasn't endeared himself to the Arsenal faithful. He said that he's always wanted to play for Manchester United. We hear this quite often when a player in these clubs.
It's certainly the case, you know. Every time a player leaves Arsenal, they always dream to be playing for that team they live into. And it just goes to show that, you know, over the next 3 years, unfortunately, we will always be looked at as stepping stone. You know, we'll be looked at as a team to come and test whether or not the Premier League is a league that can suit the player. And once the player is satisfied and happy with that and acclimatizes to the league, I can see players leaving, you know, in many directions. He started earlier this season with Chamberlain. You know, he decided to go. He made his intent very clear. Sanchez is now going, and I'm sorry to say, but it looks to me that Ozil may well,
yep,
may well go.
You've got Ozil and you've got Mkhitaryan, really both of them in the same team. I see potentially Mkhitaryan as a replacement for Ozil. Ozil still hasn't signed a deal.
Mm-hmm.
Arsenal, they play a certain type of way. I don't think they need any more number 10s. For me, that's exactly what they've picked up in Mkhitaryan. Even Iwobi could probably do a job, you know, in a playmaker position. Jack Wilshere can definitely do a job there. So for me, you haven't necessarily replaced like for like with Sanchez and Mkhitaryan.
Wait, no, I completely agree. You know, it looks to me that there could be some football Tetris taking place where we're going to be moving, you know, a lot of players in different positions to allow to compensate for the loss of the ones that we have it. And you're quite right, Frankie B. It seems to me that Ozil could potentially go, because the rationale would be, well, if Ozil goes, we have a number of key players in the Arsenal team that can compensate for his departure, you know, and me.
But if you look at the benefit to both teams, you know, we said Sanchez is going to improve Man United's team, no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
They're going to get more goals from him.
Mm-hmm.
Mkhitaryan, on the other hand, is he going to improve Arsenal? For me, they've already got players that, you know, can do what Mkhitaryan can do. So I don't think it's a great move. I really don't. I think it is a stopgap from a bad situation. Now, Pascal, just moving on. Aubameyang, all right, there's big talk. He might sign for Arsenal for $53 million. Now, the word is Ivan Gazidis, and Arsenal's new head of recruitment, top scout,
They're over there in Germany and they're trying to negotiate and seal a deal for Aubameyang. Is it a question of you'll believe it when you see it?
I believe so, you know. I believe so. It's just not going to be a straightforward deal. Although, you know, I have heard talks, you know, through the Gabonese press that, you know, Patrick Emerick Aubameyang does want to go to the Emirates Stadium, and it's likely that he's going, that was going to be his next destination. But with Arsenal, anything can happen, you know.
Because you remember, we almost signed Messi, we almost signed Ronaldo. The list is endless. We almost signed Zlatan Ibrahimovic. So, just be careful, Arsenal fans.
It's you know, it's not over until he's over. And whilst I know that the Arsenal representatives are in Germany and they're talking, you know, Patrick Emerick Aubameyang himself has agreed terms as well with the club. It doesn't mean that he's coming. You know, there still could be, you know, a very last ditch, you know, in the negotiation. It's Arsenal Football Club I did the other day, but anything can happen. You're absolutely correct.
We'll keep you updated with the transfer window as we go along, week by week, day by day. Now, Pascal, that's our time. I'd like to thank all the listeners for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the interviews. Join us again next week for another Pep Talk UK podcast. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button and leave your comments in the box below. Thank you. Pep.